What's it? Am I good? Am I okay? Excellent. That's what I'm talking about. Hi there. Welcome to A Hit Is a Hit Is a Hit, which is true. My esteemed colleague at the LA Times, Scott Collins, says that a showrunner is a curious hybrid of starry-eyed artists and tough-as-nails operational managers. They're not just writers, they're not just producers. They hire and fire writers and crew members, mind budgets, develop storylines, write scripts, cast actors, and run interference with studio and network bosses. As a friend of mine who asked not to be quoted by name said, it's an executive producer who actually executive produces. With us today, we have Jenny Bicks. Jenny Bicks has written for Sex and the City, Leap of Faith, and many other television series, all the way back to It Had to Be You. She is currently the showrunner on Showtime's The Big C and created the series Leap of Faith for ABC. And we have a clip from The Big C for you right now.
Anne's right. We're a team.
Oh, no, this is my show.
It worked exactly as I planned.
That was from the crossover episode.
And I could do chemo, but I'd just be buying a little more time, and it would mean a lot of people taking care of me, and it's just not my thing. You know what makes me feel better, though, if I'm being honest? It makes me feel better to think that we're all dying. All of us. And when you have a kid, you expect that you'll die before they do. I mean, even though you try not to think about it, at least you hope to God you do. So if I think about it that way, hey, I'm living the dream. I'm here all year, performing at stage four. Oh, come on. Come on, you gotta give it up for me a little bit. It's kind of funny. Death comedy? I'm warning you that this laughter might turn into a sob in a second. Yeah. There it goes. As long as I'm being raw and vulnerable here, I might as well tell you I'm feeling very much in love with you right now. It could just be gratitude. You want to see my boobs? No one else seems to give a shit.
This little life of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, yeah. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. I let it shine, let it shine.
She was good. Who was that? What's the name of that actress?
I don't know. We replaced her after the pilot.
Next to Jenny, we have Michael Schur. Michael wrote for Saturday Night Live for 6 seasons and was a writer and producer on The Office before creating Parks and Recreation, also for NBC. Last year, he directed the Decemberists' music video Calamity Song, and if he looks familiar, it's because he also appears on The Office as Moe's Schrute. And we have a clip from Parks and Rec for you.
Very similar in tone.
We're a team. We're all going out together.
Let's give this crowd a show.
Go, go team!
Tom?
I couldn't afford enough premium carpet to get us to the stage. I mean, it was a short walk, but it was pretty luxurious, right?
Okay.
Ray, smile away. Smile away.
I'm holding the dog. He is peeing. He is now peeing. And I'm putting him down.
No, no, no. Ronnie only has three legs. No.
I'm scared.
Ron? There's no stairs. How do I get to the stage?
So guys, both of you have the distinction of working on shows that are multi-season and now have, but you've also been in the business for long enough to have sort of been through all the different paces. Can you tell me what you think makes a hit?
I think the answer to that question today is very different maybe from what it was 10 years ago, personally. The landscape is so cluttered and there's so much content everywhere that I think at some level it's just about cutting through the white noise and the landscape. You know, my four-year-old son can operate an iPad better than I can, and there are so many, it boggles the mind to think of how many options that he has for entertainment in his life. When I was a kid, we had blocks. And I think that to me, it's about just anything that's sticky, that people care about and are passionate about, that people write about on the internet, that people create memes for, or I don't know, just pay attention to at some level. It seems like that's the definition at this point. It's about creating a chunk of people, or creating something that a chunk of people really care about. That's as close as I can come.
Cool. Yeah, that's pretty, what he said. No, I mean, I think things have changed so much since, like, I created the show Leap of Faith that was on NBC, and they'd put it on after Friends, when Friends was at its peak, and it held on to something like 82% of the Friends audience, and that wasn't enough then, you know? It was off, it was here and gone. And now I think those numbers you don't even look for anymore, because things have become more niche, and so it becomes less about, you know, and then the big three networks still, it's about numbers, but it also can be about critical acclaim, certainly at Showtime. It becomes just as much about awards and what the critics say and the viewers really enjoying what it's about. I think, too, internationally, does the show have legs somewhere else? So it's much more complicated than it used to be in a good way. You can have a hit that isn't necessarily watched by 20 million people.
I read that there was, when Lost had their finale, which to me was the biggest event of the year, and to most of my friends too, the number of people who watched the Lost finale, and if you rank it on audience for all finales in TV history, it was like 87th, and it was right after Mr. Belvedere. Like, the Mr. Belvedere finale was watched by more people, and the idea of people being as passionate about Mr. Belvedere as they were about Lost is insane. No one was, it's a fine show. If any of you associate with Mr. Belvedere, it was a fine program. But the idea that, I mean, people were insane about Lost. People, what, their heads exploded when Lost was on. And Mr. Belvedere, was Bob Uecker in Mr. Belvedere?
Yes.
Yeah, right? So Bob Uecker versus Lost.
That's a lot of judgment that you have against Belvedere.
I hate Mr. Belvedere.
Yeah.
I'm finally getting to grind my axe about Mr. Belvedere. Yeah. Anyway.
What do you think... the effect, do you think that networks are more patient with shows that take a little while to develop now than they were in the past?
I think so. I think that you have to be at some level. I think that the secondary market system, the Netflix and Hulu and DVDs, mean that people can now have the option of like waiting to see if something is going to stick around, and then if enough friends tell them that it's worth watching, then they go back and watch it. I mean, that's how a lot of people watch TV now. They don't sit down at the same time every week, and obviously everyone knows this, but yeah, I think for that reason I think networks have to find shows that they just believe in and then just support them for a while until hopefully audiences catch up.
Sure.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, I would say the flip side is sometimes because people are able now to watch programming often before it airs, there can be kind of a surge of yes or no for something fairly quickly. And therefore, you have a show like Working It. Is that what it was called? It's already off.
Work It.
Yeah. Where it was on twice, maybe, and it's gone. Mm. So I think you still have those, but I agree. I think more and more they're giving things time because there's so many ancillary areas for those shows to go to. They want to make sure they've charted all those territories.
And Jenny, at Showtime, I guess the model is a lot different from being on broadcast, and you have a little more room, I guess, to sort of build a hit.
Yes, yeah. And you can say fuck. You can. But yeah, I mean, the nice thing about being in any cable situation like that is that it's so much less about the numbers. So I can be getting numbers that would have never lasted on network. And it really does become more to us about the work than it does about worrying about the ratings.
So both of you guys started off as pure writers. What was it like making the transition to the kind of boss role now, since the buck sort of stops with you?
I had the benefit of working with a lot of people who very clearly sort of taught me how to do it, I would say. I worked at the office, well, I worked at SNL under Lorne Michaels, and then I worked at the office under Greg Daniels, and then Greg and I created Parks and Rec together, and Greg is like a weird kind of Zen master instructor type guy who is an excellent writer and an excellent kind of manager of a show. So I just kind of copied what he did, and so far it's working. I'm very lucky in that regard because there's nothing about writing that prepares you to be an executive producer or showrunner. Nothing. In fact, it's the worst job you can have to prepare you for the job that you're going to get. It's like if you wanted to be an astronaut and then you were like, I'm going to just chain smoke for 50 years and then try to become an astronaut. And so I think I just got lucky that I had a mentor who set a good example. I don't know how other people do it because it really is a very different. How much time do you actually spend writing? I spend 8% of my time actually writing.
Not much anymore.
Yeah.
Which is a shame because it's what we fell in love with to do this. And you're right. It's like they pay you to they're paying you to chain smoke for 50 years.
Yeah.
And then they're saying, oh no, now
we need you to swim the English Channel.
Now we need you to swim the English Channel, and you can't chain smoke anymore. And you have to tell the people who chain smoke that they're not good at chain smoking, which sucks. I mean, it really, the hard thing I think is to always be able as a boss to relate to the people. And keep in mind, we're not just the boss of the writers, we're also bosses of people who do things far better than we can that we don't even understand the beginnings of. Like a scenic painting, a wall, knows more about that than I do. So it becomes about being a diplomat. And also for me, it was about getting over being liked. I think there's a hard thing when you become a showrunner, you do have to be that person who makes the hard decisions. And sometimes you're not gonna be likable, but you always wanna kind of be respected. If nothing else.
I've never been either, so that wasn't a
problem.
Well,
then it works for you, so you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, it doesn't
bother me.
You're fine.
Did either of you seek out people who knew, for example, more about casting than you did when you first started into the positions, or did you just wing it?
You know, I was lucky, too, that I was trained. I had people. It's very different now, and it's a little worrisome that people who become showrunners now haven't really worked on a show for very long sometimes or been around people who are showrunners. I was lucky that I, too, had people who were really good showrunners that I got to kind of learn from. You'll never know these areas as well as a casting person will know casting, but you can learn, and that's all you can try to do.
I got very lucky because we hired a line producer who's excellent at his job, and he handles a lot of stuff that I either don't want to do or don't know how to do, and he's just very good at it, and I trust him implicitly, and that helps a lot because he keeps the show running properly when I can't.
Just in terms of people like that, who have you run across in your career who's really helped you sort of through a hard spot or, you know, in your current position?
Hard spot. I would say that, you know, I came to Sex and the City in the first season, and I came there because of Michael Patrick King, whom we actually have both worked with. And he really became, for me, a great example of what a showrunner can be. And so I worked for years with him on that, but we'd actually met in 94 on a really bad sitcom, where I'd also learned kind of what not to do.
It wasn't Mr. Belvedere, was it?
It was not Mr. Belvedere.
So
it was
angry
not
that.
Mr. Belvedere.
I had a number of people who helped me. Everyone does. There's no one ever gets to have a long career as a writer without hundreds of people helping them. But when I worked at SNL, there were a bunch. Tina Fey. I started at the same time as Tina Fey, and she was just the most like hardworking, like conscientious person who just cared so much about her job. And there were other, Steve Higgins was the producer there at the time. My first job ever was working for Jon Stewart, writing or pitching him ideas for a book that he wrote, that none of which he used, but he was kind enough to hire me anyway. And all of those people and others, and Greg Daniels, their number one characteristic, I would say, is that they were just hardworking. They just sort of set a good example of like, this is your job. I know it's your job is goofing. It's confusing. It's your job is goofing off. And it's a very confusing thing to treat goofing off like it's a rigorous discipline, but it is. And that's the best lesson I've learned, I would say, is you just have to work really hard at goofing off with your friends.
So the term showrunner, I guess I feel like we hear it more now, more over the last, I guess, 5 years than possibly ever before. Has the rising profile of your job affected the job itself?
I think like some people might know my name who might not otherwise have, because I think that's the internet, right? To me, that's the internet. It's like people know who Matt Weiner is because of the internet, and in a way that if Mad Men had been on in the 80s, no one would really, there were people in the 80s and 90s who were known were there were a couple, you know, like Stephen J. Cannell or someone, but now because of the fan obsession and the discussion that goes on about shows on the internet, people know, not just my name, but all of the writers on my show, people know this episode was written by Dan Gore and this episode was written by Alan Yang, and people dissect it and they break it down. And I remember once reading on, I was reading the an office message board, and there was a discussion going on about the different writers, and one person suggested that my thing was that I seemed like a guy who focused more on story and didn't care so much about jokes. And I was like, oh man, you just awesome. Don't think I'm funny, that's all right. But I think that's why it's happening, is that people are discussing TV at a level that they've never, I mean, people are discussing TV at a level that they previously didn't even discuss movies, I think. I mean, they're within 2 hours of any episode of our show airing, there were 10 reviews from major media markets, from EW and The Onion and HitFix, and that like that people have written reviews and discussions of the show are happening before the show is aired on the West Coast. And I think that means that everyone is sort of more well known now. I don't think it's affected the job, except that it makes me more nervous to like go on Twitter while the show is airing.
Yeah, I get my hair and makeup done a lot more than I ever did before. That's for sure. Yeah, there's a cult of celebrity around showrunners that didn't used to exist. Yeah. And I think there's something about all of us who become writers, we don't really love being in front of the camera.
I feel like it's bad, right?
Yeah,
I feel like this is a bad trend.
It's
not
good.
Most
of us are not presentable.
Yeah, we cannot hold up to the scrutiny that actors are forced to hold up to.
And then, you know, you go online and read something, you just want to kill yourself. So it's probably best that we stay a little hidden. There's some, you know, Mark Cherry's and people like that who really do love it. And I think most showrunners look like,
I've been dressed in like 15 years.
And you look
thank
lovely.
You
look
Jenny,
fantastic.
It's nice of you to say.
And I guess, Jenny, I'm sure you dealt with a lot of that on Sex and the City as well, where there was kind of a huge sort of cult of people who dissected every little piece of that show.
Yeah, that was a show that people really got addicted to in a great way. And it became kind of overnight for us a sensation, because we were because it was HBO, we were shooting shows that hadn't aired yet, so we were about a year behind. So we were kind of in our own cocoon of, oh, we're doing. I've just got a message from Mark Cherry. He says he wishes he could be here. Yeah.
We were
in our own bubble of New York and shooting the show, and then it suddenly became almost really overnight. You'd go into a restaurant, people would be talking about Mr. Big, and it really became a sensation. And for us, that was the best way to do it, because we weren't, you know, when we first started shooting it, everyone in the streets of New York were really pissed at us for taking up space in New York and shooting, and they thought, and it would. We said, oh, it's a show called Sex and the City. They said, oh, it's real sex, that real sex show where people have sex all over the place. I said, no, it's don't worry about it. It'll be on someday. So we were just enjoying doing it. And then by the time it came out, we were really, really happy we had that time to just do it on our own. Yeah.
Can you tell me what you guys have come up against in your career that's been the hardest to sort of get past?
I wrote for The Office, the American Office, in season one, and that was a situation where the whole world had decided that it sucked before we had met to discuss what it was going to be. And I took the job, and I confess, when I took the job, I was like, this is going to suck, probably, because I was a huge fan of the British show, as were a lot of people. And the only reason I took the job was because I met with Greg Daniels, and I had the feeling like if this isn't good, it's not going to be because this guy hasn't thought it through. Like he was a huge fan. He was so aware of the pitfalls involved, and I just felt like I was in good hands. So and also the other reason I took the job is because it's the only job that was offered to me. Side note. But
and him going like this does not indicate I took a job from him.
But that was hard because we felt like we were kind of making interesting TV, and we just got hammered. I mean, just obliterated that first season. It was only 6 episodes long, and we just got obliterated. And at the very end of the season, a couple critics were like, well, it's not the worst crime that's been committed against humanity. And that was very difficult because I felt like the shows were good and interesting, and Steve Carell was a genius, and John Krasinski and Jenna Fisher and all these people were stars in the making, and it was tough to read those reviews. I then made the decision with Greg to do another show that was originally announced as a spinoff of that show that wasn't in any way a spinoff of that show, and we again did 6 episodes, and we were again obliterated by the same people for doing something that was in the same style and wasn't as good. And like, it's tough, like, you want to believe you're a big enough person to rise above being criticized, but you're not, or I'm not. And that was very hard to go through twice. And, you know, in both cases, feeling like we had a good product, and if people would just stick with it, that they would like it. And at least so far, in both cases, it's turned out to be the case. So, but it's not easy to have people yell at you and tell you you're terrible.
I'm sure.
No, it's not. You know, I think the challenge for me, quite honestly, there is definitely. Yeah, I don't like to fall back on this gender thing because I think in some ways it's evened itself out over the time that I've been working in TV. But certainly, as a showrunner, there aren't that many female showrunners. And most of them have a kind of a guy next to them to kind of be the heavy sometimes. And I think I definitely had to go through a gauntlet of proving as a woman that I could run a show, and that if I had a strong opinion, I wasn't a bitch. And you know, there are definitely still those areas where women are having to work a little harder to be recognized for what we can do. So I would say that that's been an ongoing challenge, easier for me now because I've proven myself as a showrunner, but certainly hard in the first show you run. And you know, usually your executives, mid-range are women, but it's ultimately the guys are still running the show in a lot of cases. Some of them are perfectly lovely, but it does end up being that much more of a challenge, I think, to be taken seriously.
What was the first show you ran?
I ran Leap of Faith. I ran the first show that I created. But looking back in retrospect, you know, they gave me kind of their studio line producer guy who they knew could kind of control if I needed to be controlled.
Who could keep you from being such a bitch all the time.
Right.
Yeah.
And you know, it's funny, it didn't work.
Oh, really?
You know what's even funnier? I fired him. That's funny.
That is funny.
Yeah, I know. It was kind of great. And he was, again, a perfectly nice guy. But over time, you do have to... That's the thing also about showrunning. I think it's always hard. You know, writers, we're very sensitive. And that's why we're writers, whether we're, you know, joking on the outside. And so to have to be the heavy is hard, whether you're male or female.
Do you think it's necessary, though, to have, like, somebody who comes out of the creative process and then becomes the boss? You think that's more palatable to the people you're working with?
Sometimes, yeah. I mean, I think it would be hard. I've never worked in a situation where my showrunner isn't originally a writer. Mm. And I think it would be very hard to run a writer's room. Have you ever been in a room where the showrunner isn't a writer?
No.
Yeah, I think that would be hard because you do have to, they have to take you seriously in terms of your knowledge of what tonally the show is, and they have to respect your writing, I think, enough to want to write for you. Mm. So I've never had that. Yeah.
And Michael, I'm saying with you.
Have I ever been in a situation where...
Do you think it's necessary, I guess, for somebody with sort of artistic street cred to run the show?
Yeah, I do. I personally do. It's all I've ever known. But it's tricky because, you know, showrunners have very important relationships with writing staffs and with the cast. And if the cast or the writing staff starts to grumble and there's dissent and there's like a mutiny that starts to form, then everything just comes to a grinding halt. So... There are situations where a showrunner or a powerful kind of creative type is a big smiley happy Santa Claus who just hugs everyone and is happy, and then he leaves the room, and then there's a guy who's like Agent Smith from The Matrix who comes in and just screams at everyone and makes them do everything, and so the showrunner gets to kind of keep his or her happy family together, and everyone can direct their anger and frustration at Agent Smith. And I think that's clearly a system that works for some people. But I mean, ideally, you can do both. You can sort of have a pleasant relationship, but also kind of run the, like, make sure that the show actually occurs.
Do you find that your job is sometimes to prevent the sort of corporate ceiling from falling on the show, that you have to sort of, like, go to the higher-ups and talk about it?
I don't know. I don't. Do
well,
you?
Well, do you, when you say the ceiling falling,
like,
meaning...
Like oppressive notes and stuff? Is that what you mean?
Or even, you know, cancellation, or sure, oppressive notes, yeah.
Well, sure. I mean, you are kind of the, you know, you're the parent of the show. And so if there is an issue of cancellation or an executive is unhappy, that's a call that I feel like I have to make. Mm. Because I feel responsibility for the show. You know, thankfully, I haven't been in that arena recently where I've been up against numbers or cancellation issues. But I think that's a call that comes from us when we have to.
Do you have to justify things in financial terms to people when you're sort of talking about the show's costs?
Yeah, sometimes. But again, like Mike was saying, you know, I have a great producer that is kind of the heavy for all of that, so he protects me from having to have a lot of those conversations. But occasionally I will, if there's a star that we really want that costs more than what our budget is, I'll make that call to them. Or if we need to make more snow, which we've had to worry about this season in New York, ironically, I have to call and explain why we need more snow. You know, those creative decisions come from me, so yeah.
Our show is on NBC, and right at the beginning of when we were shooting, they fired like 98% of the people who worked at the network.
Wow.
And we had a meeting there very early on, like we were in the first season of shooting, and we walked up to the floor in the building where we were supposed to have the meeting, and it was like a weird ghost town. There were like tumbleweeds blowing through, and it's a little bit been like we just kind of keep making the show until someone tells us to stop. Like, we have, there's a woman who is our creative executive who's great. She's really smart, and her notes are great, and we have a great relationship with her, and she's the only person we really deal with at all. And because I think she's the only person who works
who is
there.
That?
Lauren Anderson. Okay. Her name is Lauren Anderson, and she's fantastic. And we have never been in the situation, and we're so lucky, and I think it's very rare, we've never been in the situation where the network has noted us to death or been too, it told us what to do or what not to do. So yeah, it's, I mean, if they were in that position, I would have to be, you know, doing that, more of that stuff, but we just aren't. They just sort of, we've just kind of floated along.
In terms of your own notes, is it, how do you maintain a consistent tone in comedy, I guess, since both of you guys have comedies?
You know, I think it's, the key is to know, you know, you hope you have a great pilot to start with, so the tone is there to begin with. It always changes and morphs as you go through the seasons, which is what scares me about people now being able to sit down and watch like an entire season on DVD, because you just think, oh God, they're going to catch everything, the consistency that we messed up and every kind of moment that wasn't the way we wanted it to be by the finale. But it's your job to make sure that that sound stays the same as the showrunner, and you hope, you know, I have a very small writing staff, and so over time we've all learned the tone. I also believe, and this was something we learned on Sex and the City, I wonder if this is true of you guys too, that I believe to some extent each writer has a slightly different voice, and that actually makes the show more interesting. So rather than, because each episode is written by a different writer, you don't want to homogenize it so much that it all sounds the same. So sometimes when you watch Sex and the City, you can tell over the course of time who wrote what episode. And I like that. I think it actually gives complexity to a show.
I love that aspect of Sex and the City. And it was also, it was very true in The Office. You know, Mindy Kaling, who was a writer and still is a writer there and a performer, has a very specific voice. And it's like a dog whistle. Like if I'm watching an old episode of The Office, I can go like, I know Mindy wrote that joke,
right,
and that's
right.
Great. I like that about the, I like it's. You're right. If it's too, if it's important to be consistent in the tone, but that I think comes from partly comes from the actors, partly comes from like what the themes of the show are, and making sure that you don't stray too far from the main themes of the show, and then it comes from the showrunner kind of saying like, this is a, you know, let's be a sheep herder and kind of keep everything in this general area. But then within that, there should be variety, or otherwise it gets really boring. It's just the same kind of voice over and over again.
Has that that sort of fandom atmosphere you guys were talking about earlier helped nurture the kind of individual writer mindset?
That's a good question.
I don't know.
It might
other
be,
episodes of maybe. Cheers that are like, sorry, go ahead.
You mean in terms of like looking back at old shows and picking out writers that you liked and stuff? Well, I did that anyway because I was a super nerd about comedy. I mean, I had lunch with Ken Levine, who is one of the greatest comedy writers of all time.
And I worked with Ken Levine.
Did you really?
Yeah.
He, you know, he wrote for MASH. He was running MASH when he was like 26, and he wrote for Cheers for a long time. And he used to write the Bar Wars episodes of Cheers. I don't know if any of you remember that, but they had a rival bar, Gary's Old Time Tavern, and there every year there was a Cheers Gary's like rivalry thing. And our show, Parks and Recreation, blatantly copied it in the Parks Department's main rival is the library. They hate the library. And there's episodes every year where there's some, Ron Swanson, Nick Offerman's character, his ex-wife works in the library. And there's every year so far we've done at least one or two episodes that are about the rivalry between the Parks Department and the library. It's a complete ripoff of the Bar Wars episodes of Cheers. And I met Ken Levine and I was just like, those were my favorite episodes. And he was, I think, happy and flattered that I knew that he had written them, you know. But I think nowadays everyone in the world would know that he was writing them because people are dissecting the show so much more.
Yeah.
Jenny, is there anybody like that for you who you sort of look to for inspiration?
Oh.
What did you work with Ken Levine on?
A show called Almost Perfect.
Oh yeah.
Nancy Travis.
Yeah.
It almost went for a year. That was my trajectory. I started on sitcoms where it would be like 6 episodes and out, 8 episodes and out, and then I made it to a whole season. And that was my first show that I made it for a whole season. I mean, the whole show was canceled. No one made it. Let's just be clear. But it was an amazing group because it was a lot of old guys from Cheers.
Yeah.
And they had a whole very different way of working. which I liked, but which, because in a sitcom room, you get used to kind of having a dry erase board and sometimes a computer monitor that everybody's watching to check every line. And we would sit on couches and just kind of talk and have someone take it. It felt very 1965, kind of.
When Cheers was on.
When Cheers was on. But it was great training to just let your mind not worry so much about the linear story right away, which is what happens when you have a dry erase board. You just want to start putting everything up.
Jim Downey, who is probably the greatest sketch writer in history of anything, who's been in SNL in some capacity for 35 years, he still, to this day, when he writes sketches, he writes them longhand on legal pads.
That's great.
And then he calls in and he transcribes them to someone and they type them out. And it's fascinating to watch. And it's like, and there are things crossed off and written in the margins, and it's just such a different way of working. And I tried to do it for about 48 seconds and was like, this is terrible. But it's so interesting when you run into people who just have a completely different way of working. Mm.
Is it hard to sort of wrangle that when you have like 15 different methodologies in your writer's room? Or I guess, you know, fewer than 15 for Jenny.
Sometimes it can be really hard. And most people have been trained within a realm about how to break a story. But occasionally, I on Men in Trees, I had a team of writers who had a very, very different way of working. And it actually became too hard for them to work in a group environment to break stories. Mm. It just was too, it's not how their brains worked. But for the most part, you learn the methodology of each show and you figure out how to do what you do within it.
True.
Yeah.
Same for you, Michael.
No, everyone who works on our show, with few exceptions, is like 26 and they all just stare at their phones all day. So
you allow phones in your room?
No, we just banned them.
You cannot have phones in
your room. A set-wide and workplace-wide ban on cell phones during meetings just occurred recently because it was ridiculous. I mean,
there's
a lot
of words with friends happening.
Yeah, there's a lot of Twitter and a lot of words with friends. Yeah. But there's a couple guys who are older and more experienced who are consultants. But they have worked in enough rooms in over the years that they kind of roll with anything. So it's not that bad.
Except colleagues working on their cell phones, I would imagine.
Yeah, that was new to them too. but that's not a problem anymore.
I think I'll open it up to questions if anybody'd like to. I think someone will come around with a microphone, or is there a mic back there? Okay. Yes, ma'am. Do you mind to wait on the mic, please? Sorry, she's coming to you. Yeah.
So, I've heard there's this rumor that there's this showrunner's boot camp for showrunners who have never done it before, and it's really top secret, and you guys get to go and like to a retreat and meet with people who have done it before, and you kind of learn all of the secrets of being a showrunner. Is that true? Does
yes,
it
it's in Area 51.
Oh, my God.
It's deep in the Nevada desert.
Well, I'm going to do a shame spiral because I'm like, I've never been invited to this.
Yeah, no, I've never heard
of such a thing.
Yeah.
The Writers Guild has a showrunner training program.
Uh-huh.
I don't think it's that much fun. I don't think you get to go anywhere special. But I do.
Well,
they have a
program. It's run by the Writers Guild, and it's the showrunner training program, I think it's called. And they do have guest speakers come in, you know, big hotshotty people come in and say, here's what I've learned and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I did not go to it. It just started like two or three years ago or something. But
as a showrunner, you're responsible for the budget of the show, correct?
Kind of responsible for everything, yeah.
Okay.
Ultimately.
That's all. Thanks.
Yes, sir.
Do you ever get involved with the social media aspects of promoting your show, or is that solely the network? Curious about that.
Yeah, we do. That is one huge difference, I would say, in show running now as opposed to even 5 years ago, is that you don't just make episodes of the show anymore. You make episodes of the show, then you do digital content that's put on, for us, NBC.com. We have something like 150 active web pages in our little digital universe. There are Twitter accounts for the characters. There's it's kind of what you have to do nowadays, and it's you know, it's just part of the gig. So yeah, we get very involved in it, and there's a NBC has a digital marketing team that helps, but anything that's content we want to be in charge of because we kind of feel like we should be. So it's a lot of extra work, but it's also just you can bitch all you want, but it's sort of the way it has to happen nowadays.
You also build the brand. How else do you build a brand? I guess that's my question.
How else would you build a brand?
How else do you specifically build your brand?
Oh.
Other than social media?
Well, I don't know.
Do you
I mean,
have a brand?
Yeah, Mercedes is my brand.
Okay.
You kind of try any way you can. We released a book this year that was ostensibly written by Amy Poehler's character. And then we did an episode of the show that was about the fact that she had written that book. And I mean, you're kind of in this crowded universe that we live in, you're kind of looking for any possible way to just get the name of the show out there and try to, you know, get people interested. So a lot of that is, I mean, we're like way behind on Facebook. There's other shows that have like massive Facebook presences and we don't. But I kind of think Facebook is a fad. But we, yeah, like Twitter accounts, Facebook pages, web pages, anything we can possibly think of, we're trying to exploit.
We do the same thing. We do, you know, every writer does a blog when it's their episode that's airing, and I'm now on Twitter.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I was a very late adapter. I really didn't want to go there, but I understand the use of it for the show. And the thing you always remember, too, you're reminded of all the time, is now with the way our technological world is, you could be talking to the Jewish Journal in Long Island and something you say becomes the thing that sells your show that year, and you just don't know at any time what could get picked up from this room that can be the thing that launches you. So you do have to always be aware and be using every opportunity.
Now I'm nervous.
Exactly. It was a warning. You have 3 minutes and 24 minutes and 24 seconds left to fix
it. We have time for a couple
minutes. Ms. Bicks. I'll preface this by saying I love the Big C.
Thank you.
However, if I were going to sit down and say, I'd like to construct a hit show, I guess I'll make it a comic show about a woman with terminal cancer. Mm. I can't imagine how that could have happened. Can you sort of explain that and why you thought it would work?
Well, I will say this. This is the first show I've run that I did not create. So that being said, I think it's amazing that they were able to sell that show and to get that pilot made. The challenge for us always, you know, look, I think you'd probably agree, like comedy is somewhere between, you know, tragedy and real life, and we always try, you know, that clip in particular was rather serious, that was from the pilot, but you can see that at the end we do what we call a treacle cutter, so you have that moment with the dog where she says, you want to see my boobs. But ultimately, the show isn't about cancer, it's about life. You know, it really is about how do you live your life in the fullest way. And so there's a huge amount of absurd comedy that comes from that. When you're faced with what you're going to do with the rest of your life, you can take any chances you want to take. People will kind of give you a free pass because you can play the cancer card. So there's actually a ton of comedy to be had around it. And we don't really focus too much on the cancer aspect versus the fact that she's up against her own mortality, which we all are. So. Why not have some fun with it?
I was wondering, how was the syndicates involved in getting the show together?
Hello,
I was wondering how Sony was involved to get
right.
the show together.
Sony is the studio, so the financer of it. And so it was originally pitched to them, and then they took it out with the writer, Darlene Hunt, who wrote the pilot. And it was actually, to go back to your question, ABC wanted it as well. So there were numerous places who actually were willing to take a chance on a cancer comedy. And so they're actually our finance. They're the ones that, when I want more snow, I get the call from them. I don't get the call from Showtime.
I think we are out of time, but thank you both so much for being here. Jenny Bicks and Michael Schur.
Thank you.